My name is Vladimir, and my project is called the Divina Commedia 2.0 in pursuit of the white rose. So for the presentation, I've made it into 9 parts. First of all, I'll start with the final canto, all the way up to the Empyrean, the burning heart of the white rose. Like these chapter titles are all inspired by the Divina Commedia by Dante. And to give it more of a feel throughout, like a red connection through the whole project. So for me, it was in the first few meetings essential to get an idea about William. Who is William? What is my William about? And I've read the book, I've watched the movie, and for me it was essential to keep William, like this multifaceted character, as true to Umberto Eco's idea as it is. So I've quite delved into the character and I analyzed him, and there are some key aspects for William, for my William. William is intelligent, he's humorous, he's curious, and he's faithful. And he comes to the Silicon Valley, and like in the movie and like in the book, he's in pursuit of something. In the book, he is in pursuit of a murderer, but also about this second tome of Aristotle with the comedy. And I've picked up of this idea that he wants to find something. And for this, I've prepared the video.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying how do you do. They're really saying I love you. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. They're like much more than I never knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes.
Okay, so now you, I hope, have a little bit of an idea about what my William is searching for. So I start with the final canto from Paradiso, the 31st and 32 chapters, last chapters from the Divine Comedy, from the original Divine Comedy. O splendor of God, by means of which I saw the lofty triumph of the realm ferocious, give me the power to say how it I saw. There is a light above, which visible makes the creator unto every creature, who only in beholding him has peace. And it expands itself in circular form to such extent that its circumference would be too large, a girdle for the sun. The semblance of it is all made of rays, reflected from top of primal motion, which takes their form, vitality, and power. And as a hill in water at its base mirrors itself, as if to see its beauty, when effluent most in virtue and flower, so arranged a lot all around about the light. Mirrored, I saw in more ranks than 1,000, all who above there have from us returned, and in the lowest row collect within it so great a light, how vast the amplitude is of the rose in its extremest leaves. My vision is the vastness and the height, lost not in itself, but comprehended all the quantity and quality of the gladness. The near nor far, nor add nor take away, for there where God immediately doth govern, the natural law in naught is relevant. Into the yellow of the rose eternal that spreads and multiplies and breathes an odor of praise into the ever vernal sun. As one who silent is and fain would speak, me Beatrice drew on and said, "Behold, of the white stole, or white stoles, how vast the covenant is. Behold, how vast the circuit of our city. Behold, our seat so filled is to overflowing, that here henceforth a few people wanting." So now the first chapter is like William's arrival, and I called it the Dark Woods of Error 5-2, the connection timed out. My beloved Atso, how I long for just one more conversation with you. I feel I'm listening to it, not as teacher and pupil, but as equals, talking intimately. I would share with you the truth of what occurred after we departed from burning ruin of the abbey, and I secreted away the second tome of Aristotle under my vestments. When I opened its pages, an inexplicable event occurred. I awoke in a place and time unknown to me. We should always allow some time to elapse, for time discloses the truth. It wasn't until later that I learned that I had been transported 696 years into the future, to the year 2023 Anno Domini. And right now I'm laughing at myself, because at this moment I'm writing to you from the seven deadly sins, sweet gluttony, a series of small stands that I have built. You may better know it as a kind of refectorium. Every day I observe how visitors are attracted by the sweet smell in the air, by candied apples or roasted almonds, and then strengthened to find further pleasure. And continue to find further pleasure. In ancient Egypt, smell played an important role in rituals. I know, Atso, this may sound like I've lost my mind, but I ask you for a little patience. In due time, I will explain everything. The shores of purgatory, Venice Beach. Despite my many wanderings, I felt compelled to continue my journey, an experience that was both wonderful and terrible. So my soul longed for it, and I halted, O prince of true believers, perplexed and unable either to go or not to go in. Strangely enough, I felt strongly reminded of Dante's journey through hell, purgatory, and paradise. At first, I thought I must be in hell, but the more time passed, the clearer it became that I'm in purgatory. This is why I am in purgatory, because I'm not, because I'm sure that I'm not meant to be punished, but to learn more about myself and to grow. Possibly the Lord has given me this opportunity. And this is exactly the possibility to grow beyond oneself that I would like to make possible for the visitors of the White Rose. On the beach of purgatory, the committed can overcome a series of obstacles, and well, if they fall off, they land in the channel of Venice Beach and can try again, provided they want to try again. Beware this hard adventure claims their utmost care. To avoid being judged as crazy for delving into my past, I learned a new language and script, and sealed my memories behind seven locks. I instead adopted to my surroundings and observed the world around me as I traveled. Memories from my previous life as a wandering monk of the Franciscan order came back flooding to me. What makes thy memory light such burnings in my heart? It is heartening to know that the order still exists to this day, with the present Holy Father on earth also bearing the name Francis. Thankfully, the order welcomed me back with open arms, and I was once again able to explore the world. What new land shows its head to the stars? So, and now to the entrance, the angelic terrace, the central fold. Let's move on from my past, my dear friend Atso. I would like to share my current discoveries and plans with you, even if it's just through these written words that you may never read. The Order has chosen to send me to a valley known as Silicon Valley to construct something beneficial for its inhabitants. And that's exactly what I did. I built a church, a park, a place where the soul can find pleasure and rest. But not a church or a park as you imagine, Atso, but a relic that shows its face to the world and seeks its equal. It is left open whether that is good or bad, but one thing I know, I'm too old to worry my head about it. Some are good, some are bad. Just now I'm writing you these lines from the Angelic Terrace. A cloister, if you will. As in our time, the cloister is located centrally in the complex, so it makes it possible to get from one end to the other quite quickly. It is not only tied to the ground, but winds through the plant in a steady up and down. It embraces and frames the various exhibits along the way. For architecture, this notion of the fold proved especially illuminating. And inside the cloisters, there are also attractions like the pleasure rite of John the Baptist, the refugium, and the confession rooms. For me, it was important to position statues of important personalities along the cloister. It is said that the way is the goal, and so I took this occasion to give conscious personalities from our history their worthy place. It is not unlike the rotundas in São Paulo for La Mura, but instead of purely ecclesiastical personalities, now Gilgamesh stands next to Plato, Emperor Justinian next to Thomas Hobbes, Thomas Aquinas stands next to Mary Wollstonecraft, and so on. Variety was the charmed word that led them into the pinnacle. I found it especially funny when one day a boy armed with a marked rue moustache and glasses on the statue of Immanuel Kant. Just wonderful. This cartoon, as will be explained, was substantially taken to France. And now in the center, the church, the spirit of the digital lovers. I've noticed that modern society is characterized by a rapid pace and a certain intensity, with few values that withstand the test of time. And those who approach baptism are put to the test when their faith and morals are subjected to proof for a space of time. Even God is not truly endured, and a new deity has emerged, the Green God, also known as Dollar, who lives at a place called Wall Street. A certain Nietzsche famously declared that God is dead. He signed his own death warrant. And some now venerate the human mind and technology, like some people in Silicon Valley. While I find this somewhat peculiar, it is also a positive thing, as it is very concepts that allow the true free will. There is no society without religion, because without religion, society cannot exist. So it was essential for me to integrate the chapel in the project. Unfortunately, on the site the church is chosen, there is already a small church, the first Christian church, the Disciples of Jesus. I have not made many changes to the existing building. I have made every effort to connect it to the angelic terrace and emphasize its importance in the basic layout. My goal is to show the people here in Silicon Valley the church can be fun, that love and devotion to God is not in conflict with the constant progress of technology and science. Everything is in flux and nothing is ever truly permanent, a reality that has certainly been true for my own life thus far. And only constant factor is the habit of change. That's where I've decided to give back to society. The place I've chosen to give something back is Silicon Valley, a place with its own language and rituals, a birthplace of modern technology and progress. Here then is the beginning of intersubjectivity. I fear that they may continue to see me as an intruder to the way of life, a heretic, if you will. But as I understand it, we use similar languages, have similar values, and both want to connect people. No, the next chapter. This is like the inner monologue for William, like highest heaven and deepest rabbit hole. My dear Atsu, as you know, I hold a strong interest in both religion and science. To me, these two are intertwined like the two sides of a coin. This was the key to science, to ethics, and to religion. It is intriguing to observe that in this modern era, my internal conflict appears to be mirrored in society. Despite having endless ways to access knowledge and information, people still tend to engage in trivial arguments and lose sight of the bigger picture. Like our past, spirituality remains a fundamental requirement in today's world. However, today the divide between the seemingly conflicting ideas that have long troubled me appears to particularly vast. Despite their apparent differences, science and religion share several commonalities. Because of this paradox of the conflicting directions, the return takes the form of the eternal return. Both rely on observation and analysis, demand faith or belief, instill a sense of awe and reverence, and have significantly influenced our history. And that is also for me the reason why I do not shy away from making technical and digital progress usable for the church. For myself, I am not pledged to the support of any system, may it be old or new. Now ascend to the first heaven, the web purification. And at this very moment, I'm writing you from the confession room. The confession rooms are just from the Angel's Terrace and are located right next to the First Christian Church, the spirit of the digital lovers. The special thing about these rooms is the fact that they can be accessed from the outside. People from all over the world can confess here and ease their conscience. To make this possible at all, it was indispensable to make a computer installation. They required undawned rooms. It is not important that they are not beautiful, but the beauty is the act of confession, the feeling of purifying oneself and admitting one's mistakes. You know, so I've realized that language is also a ritual, a code, a kind of rhythmic dance with ups and downs and pauses interrupted by the reorganization of thoughts. This realization has helped me to better understand and interact with the people of the 21st century. Yes, it falls and descends from the sky through the flowing history of astronomy, a simple and easy fall and cathode, but it rises from the earth on a basis in procession, emerges from the tomb, from the cave where the shadows of statues dance, rises and the dead and speak. People communicate in different ways today. And on my first visit to Silicon Valley, I spoke to some people from the surrounding area. Some just work there, others live there, and others are just passing through as tourists. I made friends with one student at the State University in San Jose, and I was already heartbroken with this when it was time for me to leave, as I was convinced I would never see him again. But just before we parted ways for good, he asked me for my Instagram. This new friend explained to me the different languages spoken in the valley. He explained the computer languages like Java, Python, C++, and many others. And by using these languages, we could continue to talk to each other, no matter where we were on Earth. When I want to communicate with another person, I have at hand a number of old and new methods, languages, systems, writings, means of storing, or of transmitting, or of multiplying the message, tapes, telephone, printing press, and so on. It is not important for our present purpose to determine whether they are natural or synthetic. Mediazzo, I can't tell you how incredibly amazing I find this new technology. I can write and communicate with anyone, dark as he or she is in the same room as me. What a time to be alive. Shortly after that, I joined all the social media sites and started writing. Some in the order find these sites a vice and waste of time, but I tell you that they are the perfect tool to bring the church into the 21st century. Why not go to confession online and private with the cleric? Why not pray online, alone or together? Why don't we stream the liturgy online? The concept of closeness becomes irrelevant, also. Language surrounds us, as does our Lord and Savior. Now for the golden market. For me, hospitality, the breeding ground to better understand and connect with each other. You may have it for free. People in this modern age have done great things. They have revolutionized medicine and find ways to delay death. But they have also often separated from each other. And with my efforts, I want to close this widening gap. If this, then, is the good. The good is a matter of understanding. I'm a firm believer that you can find each other through excitement and energy, but also in silence and devotion. This is why I focused on building the golden market, a place where you can talk intimately, listen, or completely switch off to be by yourself. My focus was to grant the possibility to sit, lie, and relax in groups or alone. Each narrative is characterized by three structural relationships. Division, separation of the lovers, the balcony. Union, the marriage. The marriage of the lovers, the church, and the dialectical relationships, the togetherness and the partners of the lovers, Juliet's tomb. To create a place that celebrates the power in rest and recreation and allows unrestricted, following this logic, the market is in the middle of the angelic terrace, adjacent to the confession rooms, embraced by the important figures of human history. And now for the last chapter, the Empyrean, the burning heart of the white rose. Atzo, my beloved friend, in the end, I can make one statement with bordering certainty. Laughter has endured the ages and will continue to do so. There are also some arts that make use of all the aforementioned media, rhythm, meter, tragedy, and comedy. I cannot deny this irrefutable fact. Nay, I welcome it wholeheartedly. Atzo, imagine that. You and I, relics of a long-gone, insignificant time, laughing like people here in the 21st century. Laughter and joy, this is the key, Atzo, and that is why I'm more than convinced. Therefore, it is important for me to create a place where laughter and much more is possible, or rather to build a structure that reflects life as a divine comedy. let me now conclude by summarizing for you the various facets of the white rose. It is a flower that unites laughter and joy, devotion and love, understanding and reason, and does not reject or analyze. A place for the body and the soul, a place where history and present embrace each other, a place to rest and energize. Thank you.